critics who looks at all the work, and I think I'm very glad to have her with us, because in a way MVRDV, one of the key kind of offices for the last few years, has been also extremely influential, I think, not only for the generally the discourse of architecture, but in particular also our research projects here at the DRL, where Winnie in the early days started to come in and introduce this kind of datascape method, the kind of, I think, a very strong ideological position against kind of a discourse of compositional delicacy and aesthetic a selection of morphologies, but to drive morphologies through kind of emerging functionalities, and that has been taken up and be rather productive. And I think and the second very important point of reference for us has been the VPRO headquarter building in Hilversum, which is kind of a large, deep kind of structure which confirms the kind of our thesis we've been working on for a number of years, that the kind of new repertoires of kind of continuous surface structures, porous three-dimensional field spaces, etc., could be taken on and be well suited to organize a particular type of emerging kind of culture, industry, knowledge economy type of business organization. And I think the building has been very, very fascinating to us, and we visited it all, and there's been a series of case studies on that. This won't be shown tonight, but I think most of you would know the project, but and as I understand, Natalie will show a series of new and current projects under construction or to be constructed soon, amongst them also kind of office building. And I think we'll get some glimpses of a new series of researches which are conducted on the kind of notion of a three-dimensional realization of a metropolis, an old kind of theme in the 20th century. And I find it particularly exciting what is possible in Holland through firms or practices like MVRDV to combine a kind of taking on quite a large projects and responsibility also in an overall kind of political discourse of the country, but at the same time moving ahead with research and teaching, etc. So I'm looking very much forward to what is in store for us. And that's Natalie for you.
Thank you for this nice introduction. I have a bit of a bad reputation of speaking into microphones, so as soon as somebody can't hear me anymore, I just sign and yell and whatever. Make me know that you don't hear me anymore. When the three of us give lectures, I mean, we usually don't give them together, but I know a little bit what the other two do, because I, you know, open their boxes and reorganize the slides and throw things out and throw things in. I think that maybe you can get very different impressions from all these lectures. Maybe not. I'm not sure. Of course, I'm not the one who can judge that. But actually, what I am trying to show you today is it's the beginning of a new year, and this year for us will mean again a lot of building activity, but also a lot of projects going into definitive and tendering phases. So, and what I try to do is to show through these projects elements of the studies that we do. So you could say the studies have in them everything that we would like it to be, and sort of ideal models. But of course, the real test is always when we are faced with real commissions. How far can we actually realize all these big words and these nice images and models that we show today? And what I also try to do, I have a kind of kaleidoscopic lecture today, I think, which is also a bit associative in a way, just going from one to the other to the next, and could have been a different order, but well, I picked this one yesterday, so that's what we have to do with. So I'll try to make connections, and I'll let you judge for yourself if it's right. Well, the one thing that bounds all these projects that we make them, so I guess that's an excuse to show it. And what I'm going to do is start a little bit with where I left the last time I visited London, the last two times actually. When I lectured here, it was always about housing somehow, because here in England there's now this you know, new elan in how to get along with that, and they took the Dutch as examples. So I was here to promote that in a way. On the other hand, I will end with a recent competition that we did, and for if there are still people here today who had reviews, they can now shoot at me, because I'll be showing an office project, quite a large one. So I'll be on review today as well. So that maybe it's a bit of a consolence after I maybe said nasty things to you or wasn't very nice. You can get back to me tomorrow or tonight. Well, let's start the slides. Should I put it on as well? Or? Right. When Brett asked for a title, I couldn't get up with an original one, so I just said, you know, MVRV Fresh. This is not very fresh, but it has led to new work. It's actually I'm showing you recent work, so let's be clear about that. I'm not going to show you all this project that have been published already widely in a lot of magazines. I'm just assuming that you know, or if you want to know, you can look them up. I'll try to show you some things today that you might not have seen before. This building was in itself a statement, because it was built in a post-war housing area near Amsterdam, and it's being densified, and as a rather clear statement, we tried to make that footprint of the building as small as possible to in a way preserve qualities that we found in these areas that we thought would be destroyed if we would densify it too much. Of course, the quality of this post-war housing is not so good, but can I focus here? Sorry. Actually, it's in this building, this area. From this one building, we got last year a completely different commission, and that was to rethink the development of this whole area as a city beside Amsterdam. This is Amsterdam with the historical town and the canals, and there's a sort of part of a ring road, which is well, the plan, as you can see, was already made before the war by Van Eesteren, which is in a way dividing a little bit the newer part from the historic, from the old part. And a group of major housing corporations in these areas, facing all the problems that these post-war neighborhoods, mostly post-war neighborhoods, have, joined together and said, well, let's instead of trying to make this look more like this, let's try to give it a new elan and actually re-establish some of the qualities which are now, of course, much debated. Can you still make plans like this? Le Corbusier shown again, his Plan Voisin. Or how to deal with this? Could this new city have an identity of its own? I'm saying new city because they actually were trying to find to make us also find ways to look again at this part of town in a positive way, and using its much discussed and put into negative qualities, big green open spaces, landscape elements. And so we said, well, we can think about that. We can actually think about making this new town, this new type of town next to Amsterdam, which is actually fantastically located also in the Randstad, by adding more of the elements which now I have to really go back a little bit. Like this one, with a big lake built in the middle, in the heart of this town, which is now sort of at the basis of revitalizing this whole area, because it has a fantastic quality. There's a park around it. You can build high towers around it. It gives an identity to the place. And so one of the, I'm not going to explain to you the whole project. I'm just using it as an intro, but what we learned from this project is that by introducing buildings like this, instead of trying to be romantic and trying to copy kind of city life which more belongs to the old city of Amsterdam, you can sort of give a new pride, a new identity, which is actually familiar to the existing. So instead of trying to erase it and replace it with whatever style is needed, you can actually reinforce it and copy it to an enormous degree. So a lot of what you see here is actually proposals that we do to at the same time add bigger scale, most of green elements and water. In this case, it's water, more lakes, combined with these sort of proud objects, which are always standing near these big water areas. So that's actually going from one building to really more a vision, almost a political plan, which is presented in a booklet, which is presented by these housing corporations to the municipality. Actually, these housing corporations are then offering to demolish parts of their existing amount of houses to make possible this new element. And actually, a project that we did is are working on, which is going to be constructed soon, is let's say a kind of minimal version of this big scale plan, which we worked on almost simultaneously, and that's to make to replace these flats, which are half empty, by a new building, which should contain almost the same amount of houses, but increasing actually the connection with larger parts of this town to a park, which is being redone. So this would not have been such a good idea, we think. We just try to figure out what configurations could replace this, not making the same. I mean, high rise is in a strange way taboo, but on the other hand, it's still valid. So we didn't want to make this turn it into a single object, but this is, let's say, the last thing we should do. And this is actually another proposal that the municipality did. We said, well, we can make this program, we can turn it into one big new building which might be in this park. And it's a high rise, but it also stands a little bit like a castle in this park. And although it's blocking, of course, still part of the view, since we make it appear like it, as if it was in the park, it's still acceptable for all the people living around it. And these pictures are showing the way we had to deal how to make this plan. This was workshops with people who were living in the flats now, people who are living around it, several corporations, a developer, numerous people from the municipality. So all these people together, we had to involve in our design process. So it meant that we bought big boxes of foam, just putting in buildings, testing what they think about it. And very Dutch process, I think. And to the surprise of the municipality, of this part of town, we came up with quite a high building. Actually, it has the same height as the existing apartment buildings in the neighborhood. Oh, this is mirror imaged. Well, you can see what we did. But what we did was that we tried to make it into a monumental object, but at the same time make holes through it so that, you know, from many points of view, you could still see through it, and it should become part of the park. So by making this building, this would suddenly become park as well. And these holes that we shoot it through, which are maybe in a strange way also familiar to the VPRO building that Brett was and you were referring to, could contain collective elements of green in them, which is also in the Netherlands is something we try to introduce as much as possible, that these big apartment buildings get a collective use of space. To us, it seems that since everybody is sort of withdrawing himself more and more into his buildings, it becomes important to not only make the surroundings of buildings safe, but also try to, if the people don't go out, then maybe public life should get in more into buildings. So there's a couple of ideas and some studies we made of these holes. And of course, because of all these funny sections that occur, we can almost automatically make very different type of houses. So to the right, there's some of the functions that are in it, and it's houses, it's some public stuff section of the building. So in a way, it's also a reverse of the first house that I showed you. Instead of it's this envelope that tries to withdraw itself from the surrounding, this one inhales public space. And although it's like I said, quite big, it's somehow not threatening to the people there. So this could be an example of how these large buildings combined with this new green or water spaces in this area could occur. This first box of slides that I'm showing you actually mostly go about housing projects and also about the way they are dealing with the outside and with public or semi-public or whatever spaces, because somehow in the way you combine them, in the way you divide the available space, but also the available possibilities you have to reorganize the building and its surroundings, and how you interpret the relationship between the house and the outside. I think in the projects I'm showing you, we're somehow trying to investigate several types of ways how to do this. This one is in Hengelo, eastern part of Holland, just a site. Well, as you see, the 70s and 80s have struck here quite severely. Still, it's quite the central part of town, and we think that in this environment where you have all this more or less equally high buildings, but all very much introvert also. It could be interesting to make actually a type of building which is has having in itself the ideal of many of the Dutch, many people, to have a house and a garden, but at the same time introducing a new condition to the site in Hengelo, and that is to pile up these gardens. These are so see the plants, and this is then what you get. So we're actually not making balconies here, but we're really extruding the balconies, which is I saw buildings sort of similar like this in Brazil actually, but they had swimming pools. So every country, I guess, has its own thing. I don't know what would be sticking out in England. Could somebody tell me? But carports. Yeah. So this is funny because this combination of private garden suddenly makes a. Make something that is attractive for a larger area. Somehow work together. This is a thing we built last year. It's called in a plan in the scheme of West 8 of Adriaan Geuze at Borneo in Amsterdam, and he said, "Well, we're not going to give you public space when you want to live in a single-family house so near the center of Amsterdam. It's a lot of water here and." There's the city, so there you go. And in a certain part, he gave the possibility that several clients could build their own house and choose their own architect. And as things go, every architect really try to be do their utmost best to to be. So this is the house in the middle is MVRDV trying to be. One strange exception here, let's say the section, the envelope was pretty much fixed, only in this particular case we were also obliged to make a little garden around the water. I think for all the houses that are there, there are two lots that were obliged to do this, and it was also very narrow, a narrow lot. And here something else occurs again, I guess, that large parts of the house are almost, well, you can see through in a way, and there it was more a matter of what you want to seclude somehow. So the house has been conceived also because it's very narrow as one big space. You compensate in height what you do not get on in this direction, and we only enclose the master bedroom and the garage, and the rest is one big space. That's the other side. So here you see this garden situation and this bedroom box sticking out. And it really, goes from the outside to the, well, actually you can't see it very well in this picture, but you saw it on the last one, I think. This is really like going from outside to inside through. No. So this is maybe on a very, very small scale dealing with this inside, outside. And a little bit also the exhibitionist way of living that the Dutch have, of course, in an extreme way. We put in some Dutch design furniture because unfortunately the house will be rented for a while because the owners live in London now. So, but they want to come back, so that's why they rented out a place and didn't sell it. So we were lucky to borrow some furniture from friends and show it to you. This is going up on the stairs, it's almost a VPRO-like solution. how you go from one box through this for it to the other in this bed in the bedroom. Very simple materials. We did not have very much money because the owners had to spend most of their money on the site, actually buying the buying the lot. This thing sticking out was fortunately an escape that Westacht offered the people who lived on this lot. From a certain height on, they were allowed to build again towards the outside. So now they have a chance to look a bit outside of their small place. So and here you see how this relatively small living room is. Well, you don't really notice when you're in it because it's so incredibly high. This is a project that I did actually show in all these on these lectures that I gave in England. But I'm showing it to you anyway. I'll go through it very fast because it's a typical Dutch situation of building a lot of houses in a new area. It's called Phoenix, and for an office like us, it's really we're put to the test. We're put to the test because we are, of course, arguing a lot against the way. Well, not of course for you, it's not of course, but we are arguing a lot against the way these plans are made. These urban designs. Often they are beside major towns. There are hardly any public facilities in them, only the most necessary. And this ideal to give everybody a house with a garden is being reduced sometimes to ridiculous situations because of the height of the price of the ground, the little gardens that people get, the emphasis too much on the outside of the houses instead of the spatial qualities. So then, if you are putting forward all this critique, and we're not the only ones. I mean, it's a massive critique. The areas like this. When you're asked to actually build some of these houses yourself, then of course that's quite something. So in the plan for this competition, what we try to do is reorganize the typical elements of such a plan: the street, the gardens. In this case, again, because there was a lot of water, there was not much demand for garden. The overall design stressed that the water would be the public and the green in the area. And parking, lots of parking. And what we did was that the plan was divided in several islands that we tried to make different qualities on all these islands, which were really different spatial qualities, and not just a different facade or a different roof type. So these houses, for example, are organized in courts. Like this was actually a roof type that we had to had to use, probably. But now these things are also can start to look like little factories. And Herman Herzberger is now making designs for these houses. Organizing the parkings in such a way that there's suddenly little squares as well. And also try to make this ultimate house and garden by trying to leave out, by trying to be very restrictive with the use of entrance and exits and public roads, to save it all up, to at least once build a house which really has a big garden, and also give a lot of people the feeling that they are living with between these gardens. This is actually one of the parts that we are working on ourselves now. A tendering phase is almost beginning. This is one of the more definitive drawings, and yes, this house with the pitched roof. We We try to somehow show it in the purest form in this way. It's a bit familiar with the entrance, little entrance portal lodges we made many years ago for National Park in the Netherlands. But in this case, it's a real house. This one will be completely covered with roof tiles. And this one with some kind of roof material as well, which you can also put on facades. Grown. And this is actually the atmosphere we're hoping to get sooner or later. So the buildings also are like huge, I don't know, sheds or flowers or whatever elements, abstract elements within this green. The green is dominating, basically. And of course, a little bit harder to work on is there will also be moving in people who actually really don't like gardening at all, but for some reason or another, maybe the prices are forced to live in these areas. And for them, we're going to make the spatio houses. We have no obligation to have a lawnmower. So there, it's kind of opposite operation. We are totally excluding all open and green from the size, just the house and some patios. And as many other types that we could find. Some similarities with the plan that we once started our office, a project for Berlin, where we tried this in a vertical way. You design some ideal types, and then there are sort of residues which are sometimes even much more beautiful than this pure types. So again, it's a kind of play with this sort of traditional set of givens, of tools. You have, there's a street, there's the garden, there's the house. Trying to reorganize it again and again within all the boundaries and constraints that housing has, up to people telling you how wide the span should be and in what way the roof should be pitched. Needless to say that we had to go to the elderman of the municipality in this case, because we had to ask for some exception of regulations. And in fact, they they agreed. Try to make glass roofs as much as possible over these houses, so that the main facade is actually the sky. That was all dealing with these matters of density related to housing and living conditions. Another one we did was actually for a completely different type of program, and had to do with studies we did earlier for ways how to use all this area next to areas next to highways. And one of the results of the study was that actually it can be very attractive to be beside the highway. I mean, lots of companies know that. And but of course, then it would be interesting not only to be seen from the highway, but to also have an address along this highway. And so we developed a pattern which we call a Brussels lace of a lot of exits, which have exits themselves again, and which are related to different speeds. So as not to frustrate the speed on the main road, because that's already becoming a bit problem in Holland, that a lot of the so-called highways are actually not so fast anymore, because more and more municipalities have need more and more exits to get to new parts of their towns. But to keep the speed on the main road, but still have a lot of addresses. And so these are just some of these some more theoretical studies of this, and we could actually apply it in a modest way near Eindhoven. They wanted to make a new industrial area with lots of mainly big distribution halls near their ring road, and is also near a new housing development they are planning. So this is what you get when you make these. So there's some kind of decent green plan. It's all neatly organized. Lots of cars, some offices, and mainly these big halls. Not a very attractive thing. So we, for Dutch standards, took the very heroic position. Why can't all these distribution halls be combined? Which is, in some other countries, not really a problem. But for Dutch for Dutch municipalities, it still comes as a shock. And at the same time, instead of making this poor street in these areas, try to develop this area into a park, which can have a double function, because, of course, these areas are often completely deserted in the weekends. Maybe we can use the space we save by pushing together all these halls to making a park. So therefore, what we did was we made a connection to the main ring road, but also the road leading through. We divided into two one-way streets, and this we further developed. So there's a lot of addresses. Actually, everybody will be having his address on his main road through this project. The sizes of the curves are related to the curves that vans and trucks can make. It's actually also quite safe system. We organize all the parking around these. So this is the road system. Also along these addresses, we push together all these big halls into a couple of really big buildings. This is a part with offices, and. We also had to propose a phasing of how to build this big building. So, of course, we did sort of propositions how to make contours work and how to make them grow together. And, well, very practical stuff, but has to be done. We try to give views on the environment as much as possible. So that's the reason behind the positioning of these big ones. And all the spaces left over are transformed into all types of greens and plants and uses that can be used by the people who will live around this area. So here you see the plan. Offices moved actually from here to there. But so this is now actually being executed in that sense, that the roads are being made and the first companies are starting to make their plans. And I think it's a very good example of sort of double use and densifying, but at the same time not eating up everything around it, but making it it's at the same time now a park and an office distribution park. So it's a more glamorous brochure images, of course. And then suddenly these big, anonymous, closed buildings, when you put them all together, become sort of massive, beautiful, massive, big boys and girls. Cars parked around. So this is actually the site. So, oh sorry, here. So that's what it's going to look like on the map of Eindhoven, sooner or later. We are actually, this idea can be used in more places. We're looking at that now. Okay, another box. So, like I said, everything I show you is being made, and in all cases, some of the proposition, yeah, some of the positions we have taken, and some of the exercises we did are implemented. Sometimes, of course, it works the other way around. That you get ideas from these plans, but. The next box, I'm going to show you, is actually again going one step further than what I showed you now, which is still sort of in a flat surface. It's redividing functions, redividing areas which we still know and somehow recognize as parks and gardens and balconies, and it's sort of juggling with known elements. Still, I think the new combinations lead to new surroundings and new areas, and maybe also already have massive effects on how municipalities have to think about the public space and how they want to maintain it. And I mean, in the last scheme, the landscape, a landscape designer had to have huge debates about explaining to people, yes, this is going to be a park and you will have to maintain it and you can access it. They actually thought it was more like, some people thought it would be more like an image of a park than it would actually be accessible. So it's it might look simple, but still, takes a lot of energy to actually make it totally accessible and totally public. Have the next, should I put it on? Because I was trying to fill the gap between between the boxes of slides. Next time I'll come, I promise I have this sort of flashy computer stuff. Things. I was really impressed today with all the presentations, and yeah, you made me realize. I'll go to this Capilux shop next week to explain them the terror of slides and these boxes. And then I don't have to argue anymore with Jacob and Winnie, like who has the original slide somewhere at home, and you know. Okay, so I managed to keep these slides out of the hands of my colleagues. And another project I'm showing you is a school we do in the eastern part of Holland again, Nijmegen. A very big one, and schools are actually, like I think most parts of the world, buildings where you have the smallest budgets thinkable. I mean, you cannot imagine what you can do with this budget when you get it. You just sort of try to ignore it for some time until you have to make the first budget calculations and. But okay, I won't bother you with that too much. Actually, the plan started already a long time ago, and at that time we were still asked to make an urban design, a master plan, to build many schools, and still let these schools work together as one new institute. This is a school which is, let's say, in hierarchy one step lower than the university. There's a university nearby. With all these big buildings, so they were trying to compete somehow, have an image, but also have their own image. And they were relocating all of their schools, which are scattered around two cities, to one site. Actually, that was the initial plan. And they asked us to think about how to do that, because it would be a lot of phasing, different architects involved, this whole question of the image combined with the university nearby, with its big building. On the other hand, the site was also edged by very small houses, which you see in front. And so the first thing we did was say, well, we should sort of smack all these schools who are actually turning the slide now together to maybe one big new school. And you don't have to worry because you get your complete site back on the roof of this building. So we make it quite low, only two levels. And then you have a huge campus on top of it available for you, which I think will only be used for cars for less than 50%. And I said, yeah, great, that's good. And we imagined incredibly different types of architects making all these different buildings, hoping that they would really do their own thing so that if you would wander from one school to another, you would really enter new worlds. More business-like with the economy students, and there were some art and music students in it as well, which could have their own environments again, and this all blurred together would be this new school. But as time passed by, they were asking us to do the first phase. A lot of things changed. Schools didn't want to move. Some schools went to other places or merged with parts of the university. And we actually ended up making one building, which was not as pure anymore as the other ones, because it would have in it three schools, actually. And would be built in one go, and would be the only building on site for a long time. So. There you go, having made the master plan that was made into the plan of the municipality according to which all buildings should be built on this site. And yeah, the new phase of making this school was quite extreme. This is going to be the program of this school, showing all the classes and the tutor rooms and some bigger ones, fortunately, in the plan. So let this sink in for a while. So actually quite beautiful image, but still. This is also showing the proportions between the amount of tara space, or not specified space, and specified space. So for you architects, this is like the moment of truth when you make these drawings and then combine with the budget that we had. So where should this go? And still in the back of our heads, this old ideals that we had. So what you try to do then, of course, and I'm really sorry that I can't do this in this interactive way that we saw today, that hypertexting, hyperlinking all these diagrams. So this is old-fashioned print slide thing, but I guess you still get the drift. These are the different schools, actually, in different parts, and some parts which are shared. So there's a school for health students, physiotherapists, and nurses. There's a school for people who give therapy to children, but also to people who are ill, mentally ill, and there are. Giving this therapy to through dance and making them draw, etc. So it's a bit of, looks like an art academy, but it isn't an art academy. And this was all going to be mixed together. And I think in this case, diagrams are like an incredibly important tool in trying to explain to ourselves, but also to our clients, what the hell are we going to do with all this program, and how are we going to organize it, and how are we going to spatially organize it, most of all, but also how do the sizes relate to each other. We left actually because there would be a lot of space around this building. This idea of intensive use of the roof, because somehow the need was completely gone. I mean, the proportions completely changed. So we now actually try to internalize this idea of this school on this site in the in-between space. And we did it by putting on top of each other completely different floor plans. We will do that, actually. I shouldn't talk in the past. It's a definitive design phase now. So it's quite hardcore, in a way. We also try to kind of deal with the program by using very, very little different materials, making it space only. And this is and we also know already now that lots of the students, especially the ones in the sort of art academy, will start to make use of these spaces. They will fill it with their stuff and junk, and have them exhibitions there, and they're going to add things, that's for sure. So we can start pretty blank, so to speak, because it will be filled sooner or later. And so these are some images of this world that we will make. We try to position, open up the public functions as much as possible, not putting them in the boxes. And there's, of course, lots of questions about, should you still see the different schools, should you still recognize if you're a student of one part or another, should you know that? But I think that will be shown where it should be shown, in the interior, and in where the students go and what type of student is going where. So like I said, it's quite a tough project, and we have really have to invest a lot of effort in having it made. But still, I think it's will be very exciting once it gets built. And so in a funny way, there's of course a big relationship now with the housing project I showed you in the beginning, where this green spaces are sort of dragged into the building, and in this case it's completely different function, the school, and it's semi-public spaces, but still it can be organized in a similar way. This is an image we always show because this is kind of bridge I want to make, because like I said, plans I showed you are still dealing with what we know and reorganize it in flat planes, usually, sometimes already in a bit of three-dimensional way, but in large parts of the world, the blurring between inside and outside and upstairs and downstairs are already moving ahead in a big speed, and I think we all have an obligation to really think about all these spaces, these new spaces that we're making. This is in La Défense, actually, but the 3D city you were referring to already, a study we did for a building company, the engineering department, to try to investigate if we can make truly three-dimensional environment. So instead of putting, for example, underground all the things that we don't want to see, want to hide, and leaving it at that, we try to imagine for a couple of fairly well-known places in Holland. This is the Dam Square in the middle of Amsterdam. What it would be like to actually fully make use of the commercial value of these areas and three-dimensionalize it, so that suddenly, for example, every building has its negative underground as well. So, purely suggestive. Or, on the other hand, giving hints to let's say, an underworld which is almost trying to compete with with upstairs, and giving hints of that as well. So that's sort of new Guggenheims are made. We were immediately we could immediately put it to a test in scheme. It's competition that we think we lost, but there's no no official word out yet about redoing the station area around around the station of Amsterdam, because actually they wanted to. There are plans to make a boulevard along the river. They want to put the buses, which are in front of the station, behind. So it's a big logistically rearranging of this site. There will be a new metro underground, sorry, passing under the station. So it's a kind of huge change of this complete area. But at the same time, everybody is of course attached to the old building, the old station. What they're hoping also is that the way you enter Amsterdam when you come by train gets more attractive. But to the right is the city, and to the left is the river. But in the in some of the schemes already made by our by the people we had to compete with, they introduced to actually put the buses behind the station in such a way that it completely blocks it blocks even more the relationship between the city and the water, because that was actually a very important reason behind behind this small idea competition that that the municipality had, is that they thought, well, in the at the end of the last century the station was built, but at the same time it took away the waterfront of the heart of Amsterdam. So it secluded the city from the river. So can this massive barrier, which is only growing and growing, maybe be changed again? So there we tried actually, then for the first time in a more real situation, to go underground and to actually free the surroundings of the original station and push it down. Also the boulevard, the buses, and maybe even make use of the fact that this is one of the most busy train stations in Holland, probably the most busy, to introduce new program like city lobbies, such a big program that nobody could ever imagine that it would be built in the heart of the city, because it would destroy the image of the historic town too much. And oh, I'm sorry, this is wrong way around. But at the same time, like we said, not hide this completely, but sort of push through the surface of the site to make this completely visible also from the outside. Some of the spaces that we imagined, and then. We could here see sort of build up of this space. Could even imagine that that all the tracks go go down, and then suddenly there's only this original Kuipers building left, and a huge square along the river is occurring with some of the pancake houses that are so popular in this area for tourists. And putting all the office program that that was suggested, not sort of in buildings beside or next to or blocking even more this this area, but just concentrated in one big tower, and did some. So here you have this big promenade along the river, which could maybe also. Replace in a way the big Museumplein area which Amsterdam once had, which is now being filled with museums. And in a way, of course, it's also a familiar exercise that we are trying to do. It's sort of blur boundaries, trying to tie together cities in an attractive way, making new situations. Another way to go, of course, is not underground but upstairs, like here in Minneapolis, famous example of that. Some of the lobbies entering, they even have a whole, like, say, cultus almost around it with maps and site plans everywhere. This is showing all this infrastructure. Oh, I'm really sorry. This is upside down. Upside down. So we tried this actually in Rotterdam, which has is a gathering nowadays, quite a nice production of anonymous high-rise buildings, which we thought could be empowered much more by trying to intertwine them all, and at the same time also again trying to make use of the roads to get even sky lobbies, you know, entering with your car in the building on the seventh floor. And again, so the spatial these mental images which somehow are in the back of your head once you are asked to actually design maybe buildings inside. So this is actually the introduction to... So when you go up and you start to connect all these office buildings, then of course the thought occurs, why do you always have to go up only with houses or offices or, you know, the standard stuff? Why don't we go up completely with the whole of Netherlands? Now, this idea attracted actually the Dutch government, so they let us made a Dutch pavilion. It's now in construction in Hanover, which is now getting us into a very weird position that we are making a building which will work on two levels. It's somehow introduced now in the debate about how to deal with planning and planning instruments in Holland. And at the same time, it can simply work as a folly, just another very big but attractive object on a world exhibition. And filled with with cheese and other elements. So that's a very funny thing happening. Well, it leads to some difficulties as well, of course. And like I said, on the one hand, as an architect, when you're asked to make a building for a world exhibition, you're sort of yeah, you know, getting totally crazy and excited, because who doesn't want to build the next Eiffel Tower or whatever? But on the other hand, if you then start to study the development of these exhibitions and realize where am I going if I want to be excited, and what does it mean nowadays, a world exhibition, we had the slight impression that it sort of I must admit I haven't even been to Seville that it somehow a bit devaluated, not so exciting anymore. Can't compete with Disney World or Universal Studios or one big collection of I don't know, travel agencies, or because that's what I experienced when I went to Lisbon last year. When you enter a pavilion, you sort of see some people in national clothes, and you see some the best pictures of, and you get some brochures and leaflets, and you leave again and go to another exciting place. So what's the challenge here, you might think? But still, we did not say no. We couldn't resist. So we just tried to see if we could grasp a little bit again of the spirit of the original exhibitions. One of the things and this is, I guess, what I mean with this double use of the pavilion. You can look at it in many ways. You can just look at it as kind of fine chunk of cheese with some things through it. But what we try to show, in any case, and maybe it's now mostly turning into a folly, but on the other hand, it could be a strong image. I really hope it works. Is that the way we deal with our surroundings, and the way we incorporate it into our designs, not only in architectural and urbanistic sense, but also in our lives, in our bodies, in everything we do. We have gotten a very strange relationship with nature, with originality, with purity, with all these things, and particularly the Netherlands, of course, is often in the middle of the focal point of these debates about how we deal with our environment. But also with our products, because we sell a lot of it, you know. We use our environment to produce and sell and get profit from it. And we're also used to manipulating our environments to a great extent. So it's become, of course, a totally artificial landscape, and we use that. The theme to this is actually the site to think of what could then the Netherlands give to what could the Netherlands be proud about, or what could the Netherlands show about itself, tell about itself. What could we export in a way other than tulips, and what idea could we export? Since we have this sort of nonsensical relationship with nature and with our landscape, it might be interesting to see if you can export that idea. And to begin with, the Dutch government was very proud that they had obtained a really large site this time, which we actually then said, well, that's okay, because then you can show how you can not use it by actually making the same amount of space as in the air, so be kind of economic with the site. That came as a shock, but for many reasons, maybe not the reason that we told them that we wanted to do it, they let us go through. And these floors could actually obtain Dutch landscapes instead of Dutch cheese and tulip exhibition. Or maybe the tulips are shown, but as a field and in another way. And we imagined piling up the Netherlands, kind of cross section of the Netherlands in an extreme way, blurring boundaries of what's building, what is landscape, what is urbanism. Handing this to the government as possible floors, but there might be 20 others as well, 100 others. Came up with this, they call it the Big Mac now. It's kind of a cozy name. And they were struck. But since up till now, it's not quite clear if they were struck by this idea how to deal with the planning of the Netherlands, or if they're simply struck by the image. By this image, probably the last is a major element. But anyway, they let us go through with it. They let us get away with it, and cheese, you're right, yeah, cheeseburger. this is a very wobbly model because it's all loose elements, you know. So it's sort of shaky almost. I think this model doesn't even exist anymore. Anyway, we try to make it into an ecosystem, because once you start to pile all these different things, why not make a very good use of it, sort of a mini mean in Netherlands, but also in a climatic way. So the reasons why we organized things on top of each other became the, for example, cycles in that could be put into the building. They're not put into the building now, actually, because actually the clients didn't want the building itself to become the exhibitions. They wanted real stuff in it, like separations and walls where you can put images on, and you know, like real exhibitions. So it's been a struggle, but still, you could say that the way things will be organized spatially sort of can remind, if you use your imagination, you could imagine how energy and water could cycle through this through this building, and instead of having one autonomous structure going through it, we thought, yeah, all these different worlds can only truly function, be clear in their image, if you also pile different structural types which belong to these areas. Now these are actually working drawings. So this is how it's getting built at the moment. With dunes and hopefully glass houses, although there's still some struggle about that. Large pots, which could be flower pots for this to let these trees grow. A room for projections, a VIP room, of course, on top, and the windmills. So you can hardly see them, but they will be. Will be there. This is a walkthrough downstairs in the Junescape. So what you do here is you go up with elevators, and you're on top of the roof. It will be the largest, the highest building on site. Partly it will be teared down again after the exposition is finished, and you just walk down slowly towards the end of the exhibition. These are the trees that are prepared for landing. These are trees that are used for the structure of the same floor. So so it's partly wood structure, actual trees. The pots below, which were used for exhibition purposes, of course. So these are all images that we made, like suggestions of a possible use. But we're not sure what's going to happen in reality, but could imagine this to be. And we'll be surrounded by a garden. Also, it's under construction. So actually much high, it's almost, I think it's at its highest point now, right now. Trees are already in it, it's an older slide. Okay, next box, last box, I promise. And what I'm not showing you right now is, we made an installation, it's called Meta City, Data Town, which is actually, again, then coming from this project, trying to look in a larger scale what will happen if you pile up these landscapes and use it in different ways, in the sense that we did put in information about ecology and how we deal with waste and etc. So it's a very nice installation. Maybe it'll come to London one day. We'll go to Glasgow soon. So maybe if you have time to go there, you can visit this installation. Um, It's a very, very modest scheme, a competition that we just won. Completely different scale. In the polder, small exhibition. It's a visitor center and watchtower for the Oostvaardersplassen. A piece of so-called new nature, actually. So, they were back in his theme. By accident, part of a polder which was not developed turned into a huge bird. How to say that? Well, birds love to be there, so and they decide to keep it that way. I think it was one of the first times that in Holland, in this case by accident, this so-called new nature occurred. Now they're on a massive scale trying to reintroduce old riverbeds and so forth. So, and there's always huge debates about whether there should be this special type of cows from all over the world walking there. If should we let animals die or feed them, or which is all again in a part of this debate about how natural or how artificial actually is this environment that we are living in, and in how far are we only creating images of a past, and how far are we are idealizing nature. Well, there's certainly a lot of people who want to watch it. So the difficulty in this project was that they wanted us to think of phasing on one hand. But on the other hand, we thought that it might be a good idea, these are these bushes again that we just saw, to turn the first phase immediately into real birdwatch platform in its most elementary shape. And then actually so they didn't ask for it, they just sort of positioned it somewhere between these trees, but actually make it possible to look at the birds that this visitor center is talking about. Like I said, a very modest project. And then in the second phase, actually when it would become a success, going down from this platform and expanding the program, and even a third phase, even going underground, making a little hill with some facilities in it. I'll just rush through it quickly. I'm also showing it because it leads to a new I think a new element in our work, because more and more, since we are dealing with these spaces of in between, we have to deal, of course, with the conditions that that occur in these environments. And so you can imagine this is a section of when the whole thing would be built. So we start with this one, and then we'll be hanging down this floor later, and add these glass walls, routing through. Oh, it's all mirror images. I'm sorry. Routing through the. You can't read it anyway, so don't worry. So levels I'm going down now. Artificial experiences again. So even in these natural environments, exhibitions which simulate nature are being asked for. Then sort of mini version of the thing we do in we do in Hanover. Actually on the ground floor. And the last addition will be this hill with auditorium in it and offices. So this is also again this kind of folly, but embedded in it are some of the things I think we've been working on lately, of piling up programs, using it to make it work as a whole. Different functions in it. You could you could imagine it being a prototype for many different mixes of functions. Of course, it is about how the air and light and different conditions could work in a building like this. So, of course, diagrams which are familiar to everybody. But still, for us, it would be one of the first projects where we could execute these ideas. Little intermezzo, a museum we designed in Paris, Musée du Quai Branly. Where this environment theme is coming back. Like I say, it's a bit free associative lecture in a way, so I'm dragging things together here also every now and then. But I think this is a design where a lot of things come together, which lead to the last part that I will show after this. We were asked in a competition with 9 or so other offices. The competition was won by Jean Nouvel, by the way, to make a museum for non-Western art, which almost immediately, besides the fact that we were collaborating with a French office, Périphérique. It's one of the first time we really had to, you know, collaborate not with advisors but with other architects, which can complicate, especially in a competition phase, the project heavily. So words like cadavre, exquis, and things like that soon started to be said. So you can imagine a little bit the situation we got into. I'm showing you this is, of course. This is sort of symbolizing the first major dilemma we got after we read the whole brief. Because if you make a museum for non-Western art, read putting together all the collections in the city of Paris of things gathered, non-Western art, but also anthropological things. What kind of museum is that anyway? And is that something for which you can nowadays still think of what role it should play in society, especially when, I mean, Benetton even still had in this selection, which was surely nicely organized also according to color and shape, etc., but to put in some Caucasian people, but what about this museum, especially put in a modern Western European town where actually, the population probably for a large part is somehow not, I don't know what the English words for it, but either native or 100% French or whatever that may be. I mean, even the notion of what is French is of course already blurring. So what kind of building are we making and how does it stand in Paris? And why is not the Musée des Arts Modernes Western art on the other side of the river integrated into this project, or why is it not somehow, well, these are all questions that, because it's a competition, nobody can answer, of course, for you, so somehow you have to take a position in this. I'll just briefly show you the project because I didn't have a good collection. I can't show you the site plan and etc., so I'm just talking about this a little bit. I'm sorry for this. We thought, well, it might as well blur into Paris anyway. I mean, let's dissolve it in some way. And all these different parts of the world that are represented in it, with all their little boxes with pieces of art and whatever in it, and the big depots or storage of these of these objects, which are still in between, not everything is exhibited. We just sort of dissolve it into one giant mixture of. They wanted, again, like in the school, there's a big demand of smaller rooms, exhibition spaces, all related to parts of the world, and with in between exhibition spaces again to make theme exhibitions about religions or whatever. Um, we came up with just this idea of just offering a lot of exhibition space. We don't know if it's Western or or non-Western exhibition space, but simply a collection of and let this be somehow melted into the Parisian life and not make it into some kind of Wunderkammer or treasure house. And very important in this picture, make big bridges to the other side of the river to the Musée des Arts Modernes, so that you will have a feeling that it's actually just one big world collection of. You might think I sound sentimental, but we really had had problems not to become cynical. It's a strange thing. It didn't happen before actually. At first glance, you think it must be a great museum somehow, but on the other hand, it was very difficult to find somehow a position in this in this discussion. Well, like I said, I didn't have a good collection to show you, and what we did do was actually it's off in this model was put a big box around this this collection of spaces. So. Model not complete in this one. It's also a prelude in a way. It's related to a project we are building now in Amsterdam, big housing project with many different housing types types in it, which is organized, I think, in a similar way. Almost at the same time, we had to design a very big office building in Munich, north of Munich, small village, which has a kind of waterhead of big office buildings beside it, mainly insurance companies and broadcasting companies, all very, can't see clearly on this side, but quite artistic buildings in the sense that they are big corporate and they have a big fence around their garden, which is clearly only to look at. Our client wanted to make a building on this site which incorporated more public functions, because you can't go anywhere here after work or during lunchtime, or there's absolutely nothing. There's one takeaway here next to a small train station, and there's of course the village with its bakery and occasional pub, but that's it. So our client, a big Munich developer, invited four relatively young offices, provoked them a lot, but also demanded to be very very strict in following the German regulations, to make a building on this site that should be feasible. It could become a broadcasting company, it could become many little companies, it could become an insurance company, it could become many little companies. It should be able to be built in phases, and I think I'll come back to this diagram later. And it should have in it public functions, but nobody could explain us what exactly that could be. It could be a cafe or a shop, or might as well not occur because nobody wanted to start a shop. Or well, so this sort of very vague and undetermined brief made us decide that that we split up the program actually into little towers, 5 levels high. That was the maximum building height. That could contain many different office types, because also about that they were not clear. They said, well, the broadcasting companies and production companies might want other office types, but the insurance companies surely don't. Well, you just come up with what you want and try to make this space as purely functional as possible, and throw out all this Tara space, as we call it in the Netherlands, and gather it in a big space in between all these offices. And by putting all the entrances in this space and not in these buildings, we already start to activate a space which then might attract coffee shops or other shops. And here you see a fragment of this. So there are, let's say, the official entries with fire escapes in them as well, sort of smoke-free, etc. And we also allow for informal routes between all these buildings, because we're not sure if this will be one company on one floor, and or this will be one company, or this whole thing is one company. So we could imagine an enormous amount of relationships within. We put it in a almost as if it were a mall, in a glazed environment, which is a winter garden, so it's outside, but in a nicer way. And simply move parts of the facade. We have developed a technique for that, whereas the building is growing. And while the building is growing, you can actually add the lots, make gardens, which somehow already mirror a little bit the intention of the whole object. This gives you a good clue of the size. Oh, I can't focus it. I'm sorry. So this is one of these plans in a tower with all the entrances on the outside, all cell offices for small, very small companies. With galleries around them in this space. We basically developed a floor plan which could be inhabited by different office types, and we showed them an endless catalog of possibilities, just proving how incredibly within the regulations we could be, but also how all known office types could be included. A beer garden could be included, of course, as well. And this is actually more like a jeu de boule field, so to see. And so we could then imagine that not all floors would be actually office floors, but you could, as the time develops, put in studios or sports facilities for people working here. Or you can make the space public, because all the major securities and entrances are organized through these towers. You could even imagine that if you see the sections, that these towers through time, when they are built, get different sections. Some are this is sections for the bridges actually, but some are not fully made or just covering something, or a pedestal for other elements. So this huge program of about 50,000 square meters of office, of an unknown or unknown use, can basically work in as many ways as possible. There, this cover, it's more like roof, an image of the outside. Realistic section. This is a competition that we actually won, and unlike I think many of the projects we saw today in the reviews, we had no clue for what company or companies we would be working for. We had to deal with quite strict regulations in terms of air and light and daylight coming in, and at the same time the clients demanded us to imagine new spatial qualities, and new office. So the paradox was, of course, that we had to deal with the old office, and the German are you know, quite severe in they're very attached to these office sizes and stuff. And on the other hand, with the old, compose a new thing. So let's see some of the last stuff. And then, like the offices surrounding it, the site is enclosed, but the way we organize it, we, unlike the insurance companies surrounding it, they don't have to put fences at the entrance. But you can actually, because it's not part of the security system so much, make it public for large parts of the day. Well, anyway, more seductive images. So, and well, with this image, I want to stop for today. So, the review has finally ended. It's a bit of a free floating thing through our work, but I guess. Yeah, it touches on some of the themes which throughout the architectural and urbanistic field are we have to deal with one way or the other, and we try to get built this year. So next year's hopefully another presentation proving what we've done to you in reality. Thank you. I don't know if question was everybody tired, fed up.
I'm sure
I spoke very long. Sorry. It's a long day, I guess, for everybody. Oh, okay. Yeah, open door.
Do you think that as architects we can deal with that sort of leftover uncomfortable space which is neither public nor private, which is not your back garden that you can use to make barbecues, but it's not a public park? So in what way do you think that we can deal with that space, or maybe should we just push our buildings to the street and, you know, not even try to do it because it's worthless?
Well, that's a possibility as well. We did it actually in the last project, I think. There the building actually almost eats up, eats the whole site. I don't know whether you should. We see it as a responsibility. I think to, and I don't think that's a very original idea. I guess somehow we're all taught also to do that, to just look at least one step outside the actual scale of the project that you are.